Good morning and welcome to day one of our ELA unit. We're going to start reading a new book today. All you need for today's lesson is a pencil, your skills packet, and by the end of today, you will turn in Thursday, September 10th, ELA. Couple reminders, make sure that your computer is on a flat surface and you are seated. You also want to make sure that you have me on the left side of your screen and your Google Doc on the right. That way you can follow along with the YouTube video. To find your packet, go to Classwork, scroll down to week 1, September 8th through 11th, find and click on Thursday, September 10th, ELA, and then click on the Google Doc. It looks like this. And it'll look like this, actually under the heading week 1. You'll know it's mine because it will have the little stack of books, and it's for Thursday because it has a green heart. This is what your screen should look like once it is split. You'll see me on the right, but it'll be a YouTube video, not a Google Meet. And then you will also have your doc on the other side. And let's start. Our objective today is to compare and contrast two characters from The Wind in the Willows. Your do now is what we'll start with. Then we'll learn some vocabulary words. I'm going to read to you while you listen. We'll do some word work and then character analysis to wrap up. So let's start with your do now. Your do now asks you, the story we are about to read takes place on a river. What do you think might happen on a river? So what could happen in this story knowing that it takes place along a river? What might you see? What might occur? Pause the video and respond to this question. When you're done, just hit resume and we're gonna go on. Now, you will notice in your document, there are some pausing points. You're gonna scroll past that pausing point once you've finished your do now, and we're gonna start with our vocabulary. There is a yellow box on your Google Doc next to the definition, a type of tree. You're gonna click into that yellow box and type the word willow, because that's our first vocabulary word, willow. It's a type of tree that looks like this. Next word, personification. And this is when an animal or thing in a story is given the characteristics of people. For example, this says the car was suffering and was in need of some TLC. We know this is personification because number one, cars don't have faces or eyes. And if a car was in need of TLC, it wouldn't get a hot compress on its head and it wouldn't be sagging like that. But that is making it have traits of a person. Personification, typing that in the second yellow box. Our next word is backwater, and this is a still and peaceful body of water. Backwater, typing that in the third yellow box. Our next word, meander, and this means to walk or move slowly and without purpose. Type meander in the fourth box. And that's it. You're going to pause on this page. Do not keep scrolling until I ask you to. That reminder is also in your Google Doc. There is a red stop sign and it says pausing point. You don't need your doc just yet, and I'll let you know when you do. So today we're going to start reading an adaptation of the book titled The Wind in the Willows. And we'll read a chapter each day for the next few weeks. This is a fictional story. What is fiction? You might have heard fiction and nonfiction before. Fiction means fake. It's not real. So this is a story that was made up. It's not based on true events. It's fictional. This story was written by Kenneth Graham. And he was born in Scotland, but moved to England when he was young. If you look over at this map above my head, you can see Scotland and England on this map. Scotland is the orange country, and England is beneath it in yellow. He told these stories to his son, who he called Mouse, before he ever wrote any of them down. Our story is going to take place along the River Thames. So it's right here on the English countryside. How might the setting affect the plot? You wrote in your do now how you think what events you might think happen on a river. How could this setting affect our plot or the events that take place in this story? So we'd expect events to occur that would usually happen on a river. There might be boats, there could be currents, we might see people paddling in a boat. These are things that would occur on the setting of a river. You're going to notice some difference in language in today's lesson. So we notice differences in language every single day. Some people would call this soda. Other people call it pop. That's the difference in language, but we mean the same thing. In this story, we're going to hear a lot of British English. So there will be differences as we read. And I want you to try and pick up on some of those differences. What are some words that stand out to you today that maybe you haven't heard before? They could be examples of British English. In our story, the main characters are mole, a water rat, a badger, and a toad. And in this story, they act like people. What's that called? Personification. So they're animals, but they're going to act like people in this story. It's fictional. So before we get started, a quick review. Plot, that's the events that happen in the story. Setting, it's along the River Thames. And the dialogue, that's where people speak to one another. This is the setting of our story. It's in the Willows countryside. You can see Toad's Hall, Mole's House, the canal, Otter's House, Rat's House, the Wildwood, and Badger's House. And let's start. This is Mole. The mole had been working very hard all the morning, spring cleaning his home. First with brooms, then with dusters, then on ladders and steps and chairs, with a brush and a pail of whitewash. He did this until he had dust in his throat and his eyes, and splashes of whitewash all over his black fur. Spring was moving in the air above and the earth below, and around him and his dark and lowly little house. Any wonder he suddenly flung down his brush on the floor and said, "Bother and blow, and also hang spring cleaning." And he bolted out of the house without even waiting to put on his coat. Mole immediately made for the steep little tunnel, and without a moment's hesitation, he began scraping, scratching, and scrabbling. He worked busily with his little paws and muttered to himself, "Up, up we go," till at last, pop! His snout came out into the sunlight, and he found himself rolling in the warm grass of a great meadow. How do you think Mole feels about cleaning his home? We heard him say a lot of things, "Oh, bother, blow, and hang spring cleaning." You might be able to guess based on the faces that I'm making. Mole does not seem to like spring cleaning. Bother, oh, blow, and hang are examples of British sayings that show someone doesn't like something. So he's not happy that he's spring cleaning. Here he is in the meadow. This is where he is after he left his home. "This is fine," he said to himself. "This is better than whitewashing," he added as he jumped with delight at the joy of spring. In this state of happiness, he made his way across the meadow till he reached the hedge on the farther side. It all seemed too good to be true, as moving hither and thither, he observed everywhere birds building and leaves and flowers bursting forth. He thought his happiness was complete as he meandered aimlessly along and came to the edge of a full-fed river. Meandered, there's one of our vocabulary words. We know that means to walk slowly or move slowly without purpose. So he's no longer spring cleaning, he's meandering. There he stood, quite mesmerized, as never before had he seen a river. He watched in awe as it shimmered and shined, gurgled and burbled, swirled and curled its way seaward. So bewitched and fascinated was he that he trotted for a while by the side of it. Eventually exhausted by this tremendous effort, he sat down on the bank to rest. As he sat on the grass and gazed across the river, a dark hole in the opposite, just above the water's edge, caught his eye. Mole quietly contemplated what a snug dwelling place it would make. As he gazed, something bright and small seemed to twinkle, like a tiny star down in the heart of it. But it could hardly be a star, and it was too glittering and small for a glowworm. Then as he looked, it winked at him, and so revealed itself to be an eye. And then a small face began gradually to grow up round it, like a frame round a picture. A brown little face with whiskers. A grave round face with the same twinkling eye, small, neat ears, and thick, silky hair. It was the water rat. The two animals stood and regarded each other cautiously. "Hello, mole," said the water rat. "Hello, rat," said the mole. "Would you like to come over?" inquired the rat. "Oh, it's all very well to ask," said the mole, rather grumpily, he being new to a river and riverside life and its ways. So he said, "Oh, it's all very well to ask. That means, thanks for asking, but no, I don't really want to come over." And that makes sense because he doesn't really know the water rat. So here's the water rat and mole sitting on the edge of the bank. The rat said nothing, but stooped and unfastened a rope and hauled it on it. Then lightly stepped into a little boat, which the mole had not observed. It was painted blue outside and white within, and was just the size for two animals. And the mole loved it immediately. The rat sculled across. Then he held up his forepaw as the mole stepped gingerly down. "Lean on that," he said. "Now then, step lively." And the mole, to his great pleasure, found himself actually seated in the stern of a real boat. So we see mole's attitude change very quickly once he notices this boat. He had said no, and now he's suddenly climbing into the boat. What do you think the word sculled means? In the text, it said the rat sculled across. We see him in the picture holding something that looks like oars. So this is another example of British English. Sculled means to propel a boat with sculls, which are oar-like paddles that you see. So he was sculling across. "This has been a wonderful day," said he, as the rat shoved off and took to the sculls again. "Do you know I've never been a boat before in all my life?" "What?" cried the rat, open mouthed. "Never been in a, what have you been doing then?" "Is it so nice as that?" asked the mole shyly, though he was quite prepared to believe it, as he leaned back in his seat and surveyed the cushions, the oars, and all the fascinating fittings. "Nice! It's the only thing," said the water rat solemnly, as he leaned forward for his stroke. "Believe me, my young friend, there is nothing, absolutely nothing, half so worth doing as simply messing about in boats. Simply messing," he went on dreamily. "Messing about in boats. Messing. Look ahead, rat!" cried the mole suddenly. It was too late. The boat struck the bank full tilt. The oarsman lay flat on his back at the bottom of the boat, his heels in the air. So what's an oarsman? It said the oarsman lay flat on his back with his heels in the air. In this case, the oarsman is the person with the oars, and that's rat. "Messing about in boats or with boats," the rat went on cheerily, picking himself up with a pleasant laugh. "In or out of them, it doesn't matter. Look here, if you've really nothing else to do, what do you say we spend some time on the river together?" So he's not even perturbed by the fact that he was knocked on his back by this big wave. It didn't matter. He just kept going on, didn't even break his stride or his speech. Here they are in the boat together. The mole waggled his toes from sheer happiness, spread his chest with a sigh of contentment, and leaned back blissfully into the soft cushions. "What a day I'm having," he said. "Let us start at once." "Hold on a minute, then," said the rat, as he tied fast the boat and climbed up into his hole above. Moments later, he reappeared staggering under a fat wicker luncheon basket. "Shove that under your feet," he said to the mole, and passed it down into the boat. Then he untied the boat and took the sculls again. "What's inside it?" asked the mole eagerly. "There's cold chicken inside it," replied the rat. "Cold tongue, cold ham, cold beef, pickled gherkin, salad, french rolls, crescent sandwiches, pot meat, ginger beer, lemonade, soda water." "Oh, stop, stop," cried the mole. "This is too much." "Do you really think so?" inquired the rat seriously. "The other animals complain that I hardly have enough." The mole did not hear a word he said. He was already absorbed in this new life he was entering upon. He trailed a paw in the water and dreamed long waking dreams. The water rat, like the good little fellow he was, sculled steadily on and did not disturb him. "I like your clothes, old chap," the rat remarked after some half an hour or so had passed. "I'm going to get a tweed jacket myself one day." "I beg your pardon," said the mole, pulling himself together with an effort. "You must think me very rude, but all this is so new to me. So this is a river." "The river," corrected the rat. "And you really live by the river? What a jolly life." "By it and with it and on it and in it," said the rat. "It's brother and sister to me, and aunts and company and food and drink, and naturally washing. It's my world, and I don't want any other." "But isn't it a bit dull at times?" the mole asked. "Just you and the river and no one else to pass a word with?" "No one else to—" "Well, I mustn't be so hard on you," said the rat. "You're new to it. The bank is so crowded nowadays that many people are moving away altogether. Oh, no, it isn't what it used to be at all. Otters, kingfishers, dab chicks, moorhens, all of them about all day long and always wanting you to do something, as if a fellow had no business of his own to attend to." "What lies over there?" asked the mole, waving a paw towards a background of woodland that darkly framed the water meadows on one side of the river. "Well," replied the rat hesitantly, "that's the wild wood. We don't go there too often." "Are there scary creatures there?" Mole asked, trying not to tremble. "The squirrels are all right," replied the rat, "and the rabbits, some of them, but rabbits are a mixed lot. And then there's Badger, of course. He lives right in the heart of it. Wouldn't live anywhere else either. Dear old Badger. Nobody interferes with him." "Why, who should interfere with him?" asked the mole. "Well, of course, there are others," explained the rat in a hesitating sort of way. "Weasels, stoats, foxes, and so on. They're all right in a way. I'm very good friends with them. Pass the time of day when we meet. But you can't trust them. And that's a fact." "And beyond the wild wood?" Mole asked. "Beyond the wild wood is the wide world," said the rat. "And that's something that doesn't matter either to you or to me. I've never been there, and I'm never going, nor you either if you've got any sense. Don't ever refer to it again, please. Now then, here's our backwater at last, where we're going to lunch." So we left on kind of a cliffhanger there. Mole wants to know about what's beyond the wild wood, and Rat says, "Absolutely not. I'm not going there. You're not going there. Don't even talk about it." And then they stop to eat lunch. Find out tomorrow what happens. What British English words or phrases did you hear in today's read aloud? You're going to scroll down in your Google Doc, and you'll notice there's a section where it says British English. I want you to fill out some examples of British English that you heard today. We heard old chap, messing about, oh bother, oh blow, and hang. These were all examples of British English. If you need to pause the video, go ahead, and you can actually just take these words and put them in your Google document. Make sure you click inside the yellow box underneath British English. Adjectives would you use to describe rat? So adjectives are words to describe a noun, which is a person, place, or thing. And in this case, we're describing rat. What would you say about him? You could say that he was friendly. He took mole in right away. He's adventurous, but he's cautious. He doesn't want to go somewhere he hasn't been before. He's wise, aquatic, and he's generous. Take some of these examples or some of your own, and fill in the chart where it says, describe rat. Pause the video if you need to. What adjectives would you use to describe mole? You could say he's grumpy, he's cautious, he's hesitant, but he's also fascinated. He's never been on a river before, so all of this is really exciting to him. Pause the video and fill out the chart where it says, describe mole. What examples of personification did you hear in today's read aloud? So that's when an animal or thing acts like a person. So we saw that mole and rat were wearing clothes, and animals do not wear clothes. Mole was cleaning his house with a broom, which is something an animal wouldn't do. Also painting his house. The water rat was rowing a boat, or he was using his sculls in a boat. And the animals were talking to each other. These are things that animals would not do, but because it's a fictional story and they're the main characters, they are doing them. It's a personification. At this point, once you are done with the chart that says British English, mole and rat, you're going to scroll down past the pausing point to word work. In the read aloud, it says, Mole thought his happiness was complete when, as he meandered aimlessly along, he came to the edge of a full-fed river. Say the word meandered with me. Meandered. One more time. Meandered. So this means to move slowly and without purpose. Another example of the word meandered in a sentence is, on spring days, many of the townspeople meandered in the town center, stopping whenever they pleased to rest or talk with friends. What part of speech is this? It's a verb because it's an action word. It's describing a movement. Meandered. In your Google Doc, I want you to practice. Have you ever meandered, or have you ever seen someone who meandered? Where were you? Be sure to use the word meandered when you tell about it. So in that yellow box that starts, I meandered, you're going to describe a time you might have meandered. Fill in one sentence. So this is the last page in your Google Doc, and it is the page that I am grading today. We already started part of this. If you scrolled past the word work into the read aloud page, you should have listed examples of British English. You should have described mole and water rat. And now the last box we haven't answered yet. How are rat and mole similar? So we've described how they're different. Rat is adventurous, but he's kind of cautious, and he's very friendly. Mole, in contrast, has spent most of his life inside, and he's a little bit grumpy, but this life that rat is living excites him. How are they similar? So what do they share in common? You could say they're both on this adventure together. They're both in the boat. They're both animals. They're both furry. Think about how they're similar and describe that here. One sentence. Today, this is the part of your Google Doc that I'm going to be looking at for completion. So once you've finished it, you can turn it in. And you will finish the Google Doc on your web page. Then you will need to go back to Google Classroom and hit turn in. So you'll go back to the assignment that looks like this. Thursday, September 10th, ELA. When you are done, hit turn in. If you have any questions about it, here's my number. I'm happy to help. That's it for today. Have a great rest of your Thursday. See you tomorrow.